Okay, well, I'd like to welcome everyone to another Sunday service of Christ Reformed Church. I'm Pastor Ferguson, and it's great to be gathered together in the name of the Lord. Amen. Yes, we serve an awesome God, and He's the God of the Bible. If you don't know the Bible, then you're going to have a hard time knowing God, because He is the author of the Bible. He's revealed Himself in the Bible. And, of course, you can know about God from creation, but you cannot know Him personally. You cannot know His character unless you know the Word of God, because His character is revealed to us throughout the pages of Scripture. So it's imperative that you study your Bible each and every day, preferably in the morning. And that's where your mind is fresh. You can give God the first fruits, as Proverbs chapter 3 says, to give Him the first fruits, and He'll reward you abundantly. Today I want to talk to you about Balaam and Balaam's ass. Not specifically focusing on Balaam's ass, but Balaam's ass, or donkey, is a part of the story. You all have heard of Balaam the prophet. There's probably a little confusion, maybe a lot of confusion about him, who he was, what he was up to. You know, there's just a lot of uncertainty about this man, this prophet. And we're going to take a look at him today in Numbers chapter 22 and 23. But before I do, I'd like to invite you to join me in a word of prayer. Will you pray with me? Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come unto you in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ, the name above every other name, the name that we love, worship, and adore, the name that has set us free from sin, death, and hell, and the devil himself. We praise you, O God, for giving us the victory in Christ, making us new creatures in Christ, that we can resist sin. We can draw nigh unto you in prayer and fellowship and worship. In time of need, you are a great high priest. You're always there for us. And we just thank you, Lord, for never forsaking us, nor leaving us, but always being with us. And we ask you to teach us the truths of your word this day concerning this prophet Balaam, and your word in general. Lord, you teach us the truths of your word. Holy Spirit, we invoke you, your blessed presence, your power, and your understanding. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're turning to the book of Numbers, and chapter 22 is where the story begins with this prophet. It says that Balak, of course, was the king of Moab, and he gets word that the Israelites are approaching, coming up near the Promised Land, and Moses, of course, is still alive at this time. And let me just begin reading verse 1, Numbers chapter 22. The children of Israel set forward and pitched the plains of Moab on this side of Jordan, by Jericho. We're on the opposite side of the Promised Land. Only the river Jordan is separating them. And Balak, the son of Zippor, saw all that Israel had done to the Amorites, and Moab was sore afraid of the people, because they were many, and Moab was distressed because of the children of Israel. And Moab said unto the elders of Midian, Now shall this company lick up all that are around us, and as the ox licketh up the grass of the field. And Balak, the son of Zippor, was king of the Moabites at that time. He sent messengers therefore unto Balaam, the son of Beor, to Pethor, which is by the river of the land of the children, which is by the river of the land of the children of his people, to call him, saying, Behold, there is a people come out from Egypt. Behold, they cover the face of the earth and abide over against me. Come now, therefore, I pray thee, curse me, this people, for they are too mighty for me. For eventually I shall prevail, that we may smite them, that I may drive them out of the land. For I wot not that he whom thou blessest is blessed, and he whom thou cursest is cursed. So here we have an account of Balak sending for Balaam, this prophet for hire. It surely is not the first time he's been hired out to do some of his sorcery, pronouncing curses upon the enemies of the Moabites. He probably was up for hiring anybody who would give him some money. You know, there are people like that today, even behind the pulpit. They'll say whatever you want them to say, as long as the tab is right. As long as they're getting their piece of the pie, they're up for hire. That's terrible. That is not to be happening. If you're in the ministry for money, you're in the wrong occupation. You need to just go out into the regular workforce, make a decent earning for yourself, but don't ever use the name of Christ to make an illegitimate living from. Should never be in a ministry for money, period. Be in a ministry because men as myself are in a ministry because we're called by God to proclaim the Word of God, to teach His people the Word of God. That's it. And if you, if God gives you a congregation that blesses you with finances, that's great. Laborer is worthy of his hire. You should never demand or require money or payment. If it comes, great. If it doesn't, you don't go looking for it. At any rate, that being said, we have an understanding of who this Balaam is. He's up for hire, a prophet for hire. And the elders of Moab and the elders of Midian departed with the rewards of divination in their hand. They're bringing in gold. They came unto Balaam and spake unto him the words of Balak. They're bringing in money. Right? He's up for hire. The reward of divination, sorcery, witchcraft. They said unto them, Lodge here this night, I will bring you word again, as the Lord shall speak unto me, the prince of Moab, abode with Balaam. And God came with Balaam and said, What men are these with thee? Balaam said unto God, Balak, the son of Zippor, king of Moab, has sent unto me, saying, Behold, there is a people come of Egypt, which cover the face of the earth. Come now, curse me then. For eventually I should be able to come over to be able to overcome them and drive them out. God said unto Balaam, Thou shalt not go with them, thou shalt not curse the people, for they are blessed. So God gives Balaam word, don't do it. Well, simple enough. These are my people. You don't dare curse my people. Even if he tried, it wouldn't work. Because God has a hedge about his people. And he protects his children. He protects us from divination, from witchcraft, from the works of the enemy, the devil. can affect us. The book of Psalms says, the rod of the wicked shall not rest upon the lot of the righteous, lest the righteous put forth their hand to iniquity. As long as you're being obedient to the Word of God, then you don't have to worry about the wicked coming against you. Now, if you go off and sin, begin living in sin, then God will use the wicked of the world to chastise you back to Himself. That's just how it works. Now, it says here that Balaam rose up in the morning and said to the princes of Balak, "Get you out of your land, for the Lord refuses to give me leave to go with you." The prince of Moab rose up and went to Balak and said, "Balaam refuses to come with us." Balak sent yet again princes more and more honorable than they. So he sends them away, but Balak, the king of Moab, is not satisfied with that. He's not honoring God. He obviously is not believing in God. He's a pagan. The Moabites and the Amorites, remember, they were descendants of Lot, that incestuous relationship he had with his two daughters. These people were accursed people. They did not have an inheritance among the children of Israel, although God did give them a land, but it was not in the promised land. They had a land of their own. He gave them a land just because they were descendants of Lot. But at the same time, they were a wicked people that did not honor God. We've seen that here. Also, they did not allow Israel to pass through. Israel was on their way to the promised land. They sought permission to pass through Moab and Ammon, and neither one gave them permission. So they were just a wicked, cruel people. And it says that Balak sinned again, and they came to Balaam and said to him, "Thus saith Balak, the son of Zippor, let nothing, I pray thee, hinder thee from coming unto me, for I will promote thee unto very great honor, and I will do whatsoever thou sayest unto me. Come therefore, I pray thee, curse me this people." And Balak answered and said to the servants of Balak, "Balak will give me his house full of silver and gold. I cannot go beyond the word of the Lord my God to do less or more." So here he's calling the Lord his God, which we know is not true, because he's involved in divination. Although he heard from God, God was not his God. Later on, the Israelites slew Balaam under Moses' hand, because he was a wicked individual. He was up for hire. He was in it for money. At any rate, he says, I can't go beyond the word of the Lord. Now therefore, I pray you, tarry ye also here. And by the way, he calls God his God. He says, my God. There's a lot of false prophets out there. They'll say, you know, the God of the Bible is my God. Jesus is my Lord. Many will say unto me, Lord, Lord, in that day. And I will say unto them, depart from me, I never knew you. Just because somebody says that God is their God does not mean God is their God. Right? You'll know them by their fruit. That's what the scripture says. Okay. Now, Therefore, I pray you, tarry ye also here this night, that I may know what the Lord will say unto me more. So he says, okay, I'll give you the benefit of the doubt. Wait here. I'll go consult with God. And see, maybe if God has changed his mind. God has already told him in verse 12, thou shalt not go with them. He made it plain and clear. But you see the deviousness, the reprobateness of Balaam. Although he heard from the Lord, now he thinks he can ask. Maybe God has changed his mind. Or that, you know, he can persuade God to let him go. And that's wrong. Once God says you to do something or you're not to do something, then you need to do it or you need not to do it. According to the Word of God. And God can also, if you're in a situation and God reveals to you His will, then and he does in mystical ways at times. He does give us signs to know his will in a given situation. I'm not saying God is doesn't speak to us audibly. I don't believe in visions. Things like that, because that's prophetical. The Bible is complete, so you cannot add to the Word of God. But God does still give signs in order to understand His will for your life in any given situation. You just have to, you've got to pay attention. You've got to be sensitive to the Holy Spirit and let Him show you those signs. Not be as a stubborn horse or mule, not regarding those signs. Everything does happen for a reason. God may send certain people in your life to confirm, or He may give you a sign in a mysterious way. In the only way that He could do it, only God could do it. To let you know to do this or not to do that. At any rate, God says don't go, but he's inquiring again. And so God came to Balaam at night and said to him, if the men come to call thee, rise up and go with them. But yet the word which I shall say unto thee, that shalt thou do. So now God is saying, okay, I told you once already not to go. But now you keep knocking at my door, so I'm going to permit you to go. Go. He just flat out says to Balaam, okay, go. You want to go? Go. I know your heart. I know you're in it for money. These false preachers, Joel Osteen, T.T. Jakes, Joyce Myers, Benny Hinn, Creflo Dollar, Joseph Prince, all the rest of them, John Hagee, they're all in it for money. It is a wonder that God allows them to blaspheme His gospel. They don't even preach the gospel, they're preaching other gospels. So they're preaching health, wealth, and prosperity for the most part, claiming revelations and visions, adding to the Word of God. God allows that, and people are being deceived. Not the elect. The elect are not deceived. We know the truth. We can recognize falsehood, a false preacher from a true one. Why? It's very simple, because he or she departs from the Word of God. Women, first of all, aren't even supposed to be behind the pulpit. That clearly eliminates Joyce Myers and Victoria Holstein and the others, many other women preaching out there, I know. But they're eliminated right off of the bat, according to Scripture, because they're forbidden to preach and teach and pastor. These co-pastoring, husband and wife pastoring, that's not biblical. The wife is not to be a pastor at all. That's living in sin. If you're under that kind of leadership, under a female pastor, or a joint pastor, husband and wife, you need to leave that church, because that's, you're partaking of their sin. That's blasphemy against the Word of God. It's open rebellion, too. That's a big problem in the world today. Not honoring God's Word. A woman has her place. It's not behind the pulpit. It's in the house, raising the children, and honoring and supporting her husband. That's her role. That's her God-given role. So it says here, Balaam rose up in the morning and saddled his ass and went with the princes of Moab. And God's anger was kindled because he went. Yeah, God gave him permission to go, but then it infuriated God that he did go. God clearly told him not to go. This is, should be and can be a lesson for you and I. You know, it says that Moses, when he left his father-in-law's land to go to Egypt, that the Lord met him on his way and sought to kill him because he had not circumcised his son. And that was given by Abraham, the covenant of circumcision. So he knew about that, and he didn't do it. 40 years he was in the his, you know, father-in-law's land in the desert for 40 years. He hadn't circumcised his son. The Lord was angry about that, and his wife did the job, took the knife and did it. At any rate, we need to be cautious about doing God's will. If we don't do it, that may kindle the rod of God against us. It will kindle. We're just prolonging our own suffering. Jonah, another example. God told him to go preach to the Ninevites. He didn't go. He didn't want to do it. So he was chastened severely. You know the story, the storm and the whale. Until he finally cried out. Many other people in the Bible, David was chastened. He had to commit adultery with Bathsheba. His own children turned against him, Absalom. Many others in the Bible, Ananias and Sapphira, says they dropped down dead in the book of Acts because they lied about how much money they sold the land for. So we need to be cautious and take heed not to play games with God. God doesn't play games. He tells us to do something, we need to do it. He will send us signs and let us know what we're to do. We need to take heed and follow through with that. My yoke is easy, Jesus said. My burden is light. When we do the will of God, we're taking the yoke of Christ upon ourselves. And it's easy and light. When we try to do things our own way, as the sailors in Noah's boat, it's says they rowed, not Noah, but Jonah's boat. As they rowed the moor, tried to bring the boat to shore, because they didn't want to cast Jonah over the boat into the sea. They didn't want to do that because they thought that would be murder. That was the only thing that was going to stop the storm, was throwing Jonah into the sea and letting God deal with him, letting God pick him up and take him where he's supposed to go. Until we do the will of God, until we're really serious about doing the will of God, committing to the will of God with our life, in all those areas in our life, until we do that, the storm is not going to cease. The troubles are not going to slow down. It's going to get heavier and worse. It says that God's anger was kindled because he went. And the angel of the Lord stood in the way for an adversary against him. And he was riding upon his ass, and two servants were with him. And the ass saw the angel of the Lord standing in the way, and his sword drawn in his hand. Here the Lord sends an angel to stop them dead in his tracks. He tells him to go, but now he's stopping him with the angel. And it says the ass turned aside out of the way and went into the field. So he just took off. He bucked Balaam off. And he took off running into the field. He didn't want to have none of that angel. Would you? An angel standing there with a drawn sword? He's just trying to save himself. And it says, and Balaam smote the ass to turn her into the way. Balaam just starts beating the donkey, the ass. She'd never done this before, but Balaam's not taking heed to the sign. The sign is stop. Balaam not stopping. It says, but the angel of the Lord stood in the path of the vineyards, a wall being on this side and a wall on that side. And when the ass saw the angel of the Lord, she thrust herself under the wall and crushed Balaam's foot against the wall, and he smote her again. And once again, the donkey is just doing the will of God, trying to prevent Balaam from going forward. The angel is doing his job too by blocking the way. When Balaam is instead of taking heed and turning around and saying, uh-oh, I shouldn't be doing this. This is the Lord, this is God chasing me, blocking the way. I need to turn around and go back. Instead of that, he gets infuriated. And he beats the animal. He takes his anger out, and he keeps on projecting his own will against the animal. He's forcing his way to what he wants to do. So he thinks there's money in it for him. So he's not taking heed to the sovereign hand of God. And we need to be careful of that as well. We can be stubborn, stiff-necked, can't we? Yes, we can. It says, the angel of the Lord went further and stood in a narrow place where was no way to turn either to the right hand or to the left. When the ass saw the angel of the Lord, she fell down under Balaam. Balaam's anger was kindled, and he smote the ass with his staff. So three times he beat this poor donkey, who was just doing the will of God by trying to prevent getting hurt. She's actually trying to help Balaam, trying to save Balaam's life, because if she rushes into the angel's going to kill him, both of them. Okay? She's just doing the will of God, and he's beating her. God may send individuals into your life, and what do? You curse them. You treat them as contempt, with contempt. And they're really God's messengers, God's servants, trying to get you in the will of God. Don't beat the animal. Do the will of God. Let the animal work for you. He's telling you what to do. Sense. Take heed. Balaam said to the ass, it says, and the Lord, verse 28, the Lord opened the mouth of the ass, and she said unto Balaam, what have I done unto thee if thou hast smitten me these three times? Now we see the extraordinary act of nature, God allowing this donkey to speak. Donkey is still a donkey, it's not a human. It's still a donkey, but God allows the donkey to voice her feelings. Okay. Balaam, and once again, instead of taking heed of this, saying, why are you talking to me? He talks back to her. Acts like she's always talked to her. Balaam said to the ass, because thou hast mocked me, I would there were a sword in my hand, for now I would kill you. He just very hard-headed, isn't he, Mr. Balaam? Stiff neck. Now he's threatening to kill her, the donkey. She's done nothing wrong to him. She's just doing a little God. He's not heeding God's sign. The sign is stop and go back. And the ass said to Balaam, am not I thine ass upon which thou hast ridden ever since I was thine unto this day? Was I ever wont to do so unto thee? And he said, no. So, have I ever been like this? No. He said, no. Why don't you wake up and smell the coffee? Recognize the sign. Why don't we take heed to the signs of the chastening hand of the Lord? Don't ignore it. Do what you need to do. Get in the will of God. Deliver yourself. Take the yoke of Christ upon us in obedience to Christ, to the Spirit of God, the Word of God. And then you remove the rod of God from your life. Who wants the rod of God? Then the Lord opened the eyes of Balaam, and he saw the angel of the Lord standing in the way, his sword drawn in his hand, and he bowed down his head and fell flat on his face. The angel of the Lord said, so now he's fearing God, but it's taken this much. Shouldn't take that much. I'd already told him, don't go. Now he's learning. Angel Lord said unto him, wherefore hast thou smitten thine asses three times? Behold, I went out to withstand thee, because thy way is perverse before me. This may be a prefigurement of Christ, this angel of the Lord. Your way is perverse before me. I'm God. I believe it was. And the ass saw me and turned from me these three times. The Lord met him of the Lord are met of, of the Lord, drawn sword. The ass saw me and turned from me is three times. Unless she had turned from me, surely now I had slain thee and saved her. He was out to kill Balaam. He was going to kill him. The ass saved his life. It's a powerful message right there. And Balaam said unto the angel, Lord, I have sinned, for I knew not that thou stoodest in the way against me. Now therefore, if it displeased thee, I will get me back again. Now, I'm going to stop right there. I'm not going to keep going, because there, maybe next week I'll continue. It's somewhat of a protracted story. Balaam, and he builds altars and stuff like that. At any rate, I want to focus on that, on those first 34 verses of chapter 22. And hopefully we can learn a lesson from this event, and take heed to the rod of God, the sign of God that God sent you. And don't be disobedient, don't be obstinate. Scripture says, he who often being reproved hardeneth his neck shall be broken suddenly, that without remedy. Proverbs speaks of, don't be as a horse and a mule which have no, had to be held bit and bridled. Don't be like that. God says, go, go. God says, stop, stop. God says, turn around, turn around. God says, do this, do that. God says, don't do this, don't do that. And do whatever God says according to his word. And in whatever situation you're in, go to God in prayer and he'll show you the way out. And take heed to the signs he gives you, the signs of confirmation. When we don't do that, we get ourselves in trouble. We prolong our own suffering. And the devil sits back and laughs. And everybody gets hurt. You, other people, whatever is in the situation. Sin destroys, but obedience restores. Amen. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for this message. Be given unto us, grant us the grace to be obedient children unto you, heeding your word and the signs you give us, and doing your will above everything else. We love you and thank you and praise you in Christ's name.